Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Our dear Imam Muhammad Majid needs no introduction. We all know him, alhamdulillah rabbil alameen. He's one of the very well-known leaders of Muslims in America and the former president of ISNA. And he is here today because of Alim program. I'm sure all of us know about Alim program. So alhamdulillah has been here before 2 years ago, and alhamdulillah he's here with us tonight addressing one of the very sensitive and important radioactive subjects, extremism in America, and how it affects American Muslims. For our sisters, again, who want to come and join us in the main prayer hall, they can come either from the main entrance or from the Imam's office to listen to the lecture. You can ask a question, inshallah, after the presentation, or you, if you want, you can write it down and bring it here, inshallah. Jazakumullah khair.
الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين وسيد النبيين وإمام المتقين وقائد الغر المحجلين محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم النبي المبعوث رحمة العالمين السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. It gives me great pleasure to be with you and with our beloved Sheikh, whom and I have been in many occasions together in different programs, but it's a pleasure to be in his mosque and his under jurisdiction. I have traveled around the world speaking in the issue of violent extremism and how to prevent Muslim society from it. But I would like to speak in general about the phenomena. In Arabic, we call it al-ghulu or al-tatarruf. When a person become extremes in their ideas in general, this extremism could take place and form and shape in many aspects of life. It's not necessarily only in ideology, but a person can be extremes in love of the sport. A person can be extreme of addiction to movies. Extremes could be in being a secular. It does not tolerate any other belief or faith that you will not accept even any religious manifestations of any kind of behavior. You go against it very strongly. That extremism as well. Therefore, there's an aspect of this extremism is neutral. It can have a Hindu who's extremist, you have a Jewish who's extremist, you have a Muslim who's extremist, and you have seen manifestation of that. You have Jewish extremism by killing the Muslims in the Masjid al-Khalil in Jerusalem. The extremist Jewish, he did that. You have the Christian extremist in Ireland, where the Catholic and the Protestant fighting one another. You have Hindu extremists in India, where they burn the masjid and they kill the Muslim. You have Buddhist extremists who are now in Burma, very strong extremists. I've not seen extremists like those. Also kicking the Muslim Rohingya out of Burma and have them to be in the middle of the sea. They cannot have food, they cannot have water, and so forth. But there's extremism in every religion. For Muslims, they have their share. But we are not the only one. That I want to say that in the beginning. Because sometimes things are not being put in perspective. Therefore, extremism is a behavior of individuals who have believed that other than themselves, no one deserves to have dignity, honorable life. And they interpret life in so narrow religious interpretation or ethnic interpretation, us versus them. That's in the beginning. I want to say that. From the Islamic perspective, which is we are, as Muslims, we are taught in Islam to have moderation in everything. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, كَذَلَكَ جَعَلْنَاكُمْ أُمَّةً وَسَطًا. We are an ummah of wasat here, meaning that we don't have any extremism in any aspect of our life. And the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam stopped extremism during his life. What do I mean by that? There are three people, you know, very famous hadith, where they said, they asked about the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam fasting and his worship and so forth, his prayer. And when they were told how much rak'ah he pray every night and how many days he fast in a week and in a month, they said that he is a prophet of Allah. Allah have forgiven his sin. We have to do more. Therefore, one of them said, I pledge that I will fast and never break my fast. The second person pledged that he will pray and never go to sleep, pray all night long. And the third person said he would never get married, he would devote himself to Islam. Our Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam heard of them, and he called them, he summoned them, said, are you the one who said this isn't that? He said, yes, Ya Rasulullah. He said, by Allah, I'm closer to Allah than you, and I fear Allah more than you do, but I do pray, and I go to sleep, and I fast, and I break my fast, and I get married. And whoever does not follow my path is not of me. He's not following me. ورغب عن سنتي فليس بي. That is stubborn extremism in his life, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I've seen a man that was fasting but staying under the heat, under the sun. Rasulullah said, why this man standing there? They say he's fasting. You want to feed him, as they say. He said, دعوه يأتي للظلم. Ask him to come to the shade. And Rasulullah have said, in hada deen mateen, this religion is well established, does not need anyone to make it more firm. It's well established, very firm in itself. It doesn't need anyone to say, I want it to be more firm on it. Deen mateen, fawghil fihi birifq, take it easy as you practice the religion. فَإِنَّ الْمُبَتَّلَ أَرْضًا قَطَعَ وَلَا ظَهْرًا أَبْقَى. A person who overload his or her horse and start beating on the horse so it can go fast, what will happen eventually? The horse back will be broken, it will break the horse back, and that person will not be able to reach their destination. And then from the Islamic perspective, that the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ stopped extremism at his time. That when people want to go overboard, he stopped them. After Rasulullah passed away, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, a group of people emerged in a Muslim community after Uthman radallahu anhu khilafa, called Khawarij, Kharijaj. This group of Khawarij, they are the ones who are very upset. They were very upset of the fact that Ali radiallahu anhu have looked for political solution. Instead of the violence, you want to do tahkim, which is arbitration. They were very upset, and they said that we don't accept the arbitration. And they call Ali radiallahu anhu kafir. They put him out of Islam. And they put Muawiyah out of Islam before Ali radiallahu anhu. And their logic that was based on misinterpretation, taking verses out of context in the Quran. They said, how comes Ali radiallahu anhu accept arbitration? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, in al-hukmu illa lillah. The ruling only belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they said, how comes Ali radiallahu anhu, he let go of his title as Amir al-Mu'mineen? If he's not Amir al-Mu'mineen, he's Amir al-Kafireen. This is a real group. They have beard longer than anyone beard here. Lahya. They have a prayer mark in their face, like the knee of the camel. Big one, they said. They prayed longer than anyone else. They recited the Quran better than anyone else. They recited a hadith better than anyone else. Matter of fact, Rasulullah spoke about them. He said, there will come a time you will see a group of people, you literally pray to their prayer, and you're fasting to their fasting. They recite Quran, but the Quran does not go beyond their throat. They're only from their throat, not from their heart. They will leave Islam as the arrow leave the bow. And they have no anything of Islam, although they look Muslims. This is authentic hadith. This group, Kharijite, they become very violent. They were killing Muslims with no hesitation. They ask a person, they stop a person, they ask him, are you with Ali or Muawiyah? If he said, I'm with Ali, they kill him. If he said, I'm with Muawiyah, they kill him. If he said, I'm kafir, I'm not a Muslim, they let him go. The Kharijite of today, they're worse. They kill the Muslim and the kafir, everyone else. Now, what is the cause of violence extreme ideology? From practical perspective of contemporary time, some of this violent extremism, the cause of it, is the lack of the proper response to injustice that you see. I'm going to speak about the ideological later. I'm going to speak now with the emotional and psychological aspect of violent extremism. Bear with me. By the way, let me just qualify why I'm saying all of that. I counsel many youth. I'm speaking to some youth in prison now in the United States. I was in Nigeria. I came now from Africa. I was in Nigeria and was in Sudan. In Sudan, I spoke to 7 universities. I spoke to 25 families where the children have joined Daesh from Sudan, from the university called Mamoun Hamada University. Those are medical students, an American passport and British passport. But out of this experience, I'm telling you the narrative of and the cause of violent extremism. Number one reason of the violent extremism is the psychological emotional state of the youth, not the ideology. I'm talking about contemporary time. The youth are vulnerable for recruitment. They are the youth who don't know that much about Islam and they're not connected that much to the masjid. Who they are moving from one state, emotional state, to another emotional state. They were not religious and they want to become religious. And in that gap, in that period of time of transitioning from that state of not being religious to become religious, it were in the internet have been recruited. Well, they are the victim as well. Now, what are the things that cause them to join? They see violence in Syria, people being killed, images of children by Bashar al-Assad killing them every day. They see violence in Gaza. They see violence in Iraq. And those images have been sent to them, and they don't know what to do with those images. Somebody says, I have an answer for you. You can do something about it. You can have a sense of purpose. You can have self-actualization. You can be somebody. Those children, some of them are 17 and even 18 years old. And somebody give them a big task. In order for them to be moved from that state to that state of acting upon it, they have to be told that to break all the circle of what they call social safety net. I made a presentation, PowerPoint presentation on this issue, or the share from my head instead of reading it. The young man who in charge of the Daesh Twitter account in Virginia was in jail now, 16 years old. ISIS. They call Daesh. ISIS. ISIS. The person in charge of the Twitter account of ISIS or ISIL, he's in prison in Virginia, very intelligent young man. Highly vulnerable. He wanted to do something. His heart and the feeling was good, but it was in the wrong place. He contacted 4,400 people. He sent kids from Virginia to Syria. I sat with him many times in prison, and I asked him the questions. How this happened? He said, first of all, he was told that you need not to trust your parents. First line of defense. Do not trust your parents. Your parents are not that religious. They are culturally Muslim, but are not really good Muslim. And they recited to him the ayat from the Quran. It says, يَوْمَ يَفِرُّ الْمَرْءُ مِنْ أَخِيهِ وَأُمِّهِ وَأَبِيهِ وَصَحِبَتِهِ وَبَنِيهِ. The day of judgment, where you'll be, remember the day of judgment, where you'll be running from your own brother and your own mother and your own father. Therefore, do not rely on them now, because you're going to run away from them anyway in the day of judgment. Want you to run from them now. Save yourself now before you be running from them anyway. Before he stopped not talking to his parents. Go to his room or to his computer and connect with them virtually. Then they still told him, do not talk to your friends. Make your social life only online, because those friends are going to impact your state of spiritual state. And they recited him an ayah in the Quran, أَلَخِلَّهُ بَعْضُهُمْ لِبَعْضِ الْيَوْمِ إِلَّا الْمُتَّقِينَ. Friends are the enemy of one another in the day of judgment, except the righteous people. Therefore, you have to have super righteous people, and we are the super righteous people. Do not have any friends. Cut your relationship with your friends. They target the second line of defense. Parents out, friends are out. Then don't listen to the sheikh in your masjid. Do not consult any sheikh in what we are telling you, because all of them are sellout. All of them are not reliable. All of them are not good practicing. Only our sheikh in Iraq and Syria is the only man that you can ask, and we are the only one have the true religion. We recite him the ayah, وَاسْتَبَرَّ الَّذِينَ اتُّبِعُوا مِنَ الَّذِينَ اتَّبَعُوا رَأُوا الْعَذَابُ وَتَقَطَّعَ دُهُمُ الْأَسْبَابُ. They told him that the ayah in the Quran where Allah says, those who they follow their sheikh and their imams, in the day of judgment, their imam and the sheikh said, we have nothing to do with you, and they will deny them. They demolish all social safety network. Now he's completely surrendered to them. Now, they start sending him images of young people in open truck, getting Kalashnikov, looking cool, and says, you could have be one of those. Then they have a young lady from the ISIS camp telling him, be brave, we're waiting for you. I've been told about you, I would like to marry you. I want to be a wife of a mujahid. Imagine this, all of this emotional pressure. Do you hear what I'm saying? This is true. This is from the person himself. And subhanAllah, I sat with those family in Sudan just now, last week, 3 days ago. I just came yesterday from Sudan. And they told me their daughters and their son, they have told them the same narrative. When they start becoming extremists in their ideas, said, Dad, you don't know anything. Do you know jihad of talab? Jihad of seeking others? Jihad of death? They ask him, they throw terminologies at their parents. The parents say, I don't know about this. He said, therefore, you're not qualified to talk about religion. And they end up now in Syria or now in Libya, those kids. Some of them in Libya, some of them in Syria. Then after that, they tell a person, there's a sense of urgency. You need to help the Muslim Ummah now. Muslim Ummah cannot wait. Come now. They said, he said, I want to finish my university. He says, no. Do you have assurance that you're going to be alive until you finish university? Come now. أيها الذين آمنوا ما لكم إذا قيل لكم انفروا في سبيل الله ثقلتم من الأرض. They quoted an ayah out of context. All those who believe, when you've been called to do something, you hold back to the earth. Move on, come on. And then they start and send him message day and night until he get up and leave. And they told him, be secretive, be quiet about it, only leave the note as you go to the airport. I'm telling you out of my experience. Now, how to address this issue? There are three components here very quickly. The issue of psychology, psychological aspect of this, we have to be able to empower youth to interpret events and to do something about them in the most positive way. If a child sees, a young person sees the image of Muslims in Palestine and Syria, and somebody told them to do something about it, that child, if it's not been directed to do the right things, they would do the wrong thing. I spoke to some Syrian opposition. They said some of those people who came to, they thought they're gonna help, they hurt. Have they hurt the effort of the Syrian opposition? Because they start killing the Syrian opposition themselves. ISIS killed the Syrian opposition. You know that? قَتَلُوا جَيْشَ الْحُرْ. Now, in our masajids, in our community, if we don't talk about those issues, about injustice, somebody else is going to talk about it. Therefore, in our masajid, we have to have a forum to speak about Palestine, to speak about Syria, to talk about Iraq, and to address those issues, and then to say what kind of action you can take regarding those issues. Take the legal means, the proper way of addressing those issues. Otherwise, they will seek the interpretation from somebody else. This is the psychological aspect. There's a social aspect of this. The social aspect of this, the child wants to do something within their community. They have energy. And I was talking to Brother Yadin Nasir about initiative that he has. And we started an initiative in Virginia called Ambassador of Compassion. Ambassadors of Compassion. So Fara al-Rahma. Where we're creating a social platform of activism based on faith. Because sometimes people like to do activism in terms of a secular approach, because they believe the problem is in Islam. Even some Muslims, they suggested, said, let those kids do something of activism, but no Islam on it. That's wrong. It has to be faith-based. It has to be based on Islam. And therefore, we're basing our activism now on the seerah of Rasulullah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. We send you as a mercy to the world. And therefore, we need to teach our children the concept of compassion at home and the compassion in the neighborhood. And how they can be able to help and become participants in bringing relief to people who are going through a difficult time in the Muslim countries. Therefore, you have to design a program addressing this issue. Political issues. People think that sometimes they don't have the ways and means to speak truth to the power. You have to bring public officials to the masjid and have the kids, young people, ask them hard questions about Palestine, congressmen, congresswomen, senators. Let them have a platform where they can raise their voice to the people in power. That will give them a sense of capability and ability to speak in the behalf of the voiceless. Because otherwise, they're going to go to the internet. Let me speak about the ideological aspect of this. First of all, we need to teach Islam according to the prophetic teaching of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that Islam is that balance everything in life. There are some people, when they move from the state of not practicing Islam to practice Islam, over sudden have a psychological problem. Islam is supposed to give you comfort, not trouble you. Have you seen some young people, when they start practicing Islam, stop smiling anymore? Seriously, I don't know what happened. The parents have told me that. They say, my kids was very outgoing, easygoing, smiling, and so forth. Brother, since he started going to the masjid, your masjid, or at the other masjid, he's very sad, or she's very sad. When he talked to those kids, they get the sadness from the internet. They told them not to smile. You have to be serious. And the Rasulullah was always smiling. كَانَ أَكْثَرُ دَهْرِي تَبَسُّبَ. They become very judgmental. There's some kids. They question the how long the beard of their parents are. They look to your clothes. They start telling them TV is haram and those kind of things. They become very aggressive in how they express their Islam. Because they were thirsty, and over sudden somebody gave them too much water. You know, I was told, someone is a doctor here. I told Michigan, half of these doctors. What that? There are many. If a person have not extremely thirsty, and have not been drinking water for a while, and dehydrated completely, do you give them a big cup of water to drink immediately? What happened to them? A person is completely, if he cannot even open his lips, and he said, have this water. If they drink the whole water immediately, they get what? Yeah? Shock their system. You have to gradually give them a drop of it. Those who are coming, who have not been religious and been religious, when all of a sudden become religious, I want to drink so much of it, they go to the extremes. You have to have them get into this by fulfilling the basic first. Let them pray. Salah, salah, salah. If they fulfill the salah, they build on it slowly. But he wants to start praying today and he wants to become mujahid tomorrow. That's what happened, extremes. Therefore, from the ideological perspective, that we need to teach al-wasatiyah, moderation. Because this group of people violated we said in Arabic, al-manqul wal-ma'qul min al-sharia, what rational and what textual from sharia. They distorted text and they misunderstood the context. They misunderstood the verses of jihad. They misunderstood the fiqh of the consequences, fiqh al-ma'alat. They have a problem with the fiqh of priorities, fiqh al-awlawiyat. Therefore, their whole system of thinking is distorted. Now, when we teach people Islam, we have to make the concept of compassion as the core of it. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said there is no other purpose of the Prophet except to be the mercy to the world, we want to understand what that entails and what that means. And that's why we develop a curriculum called Compassion at Home, and Compassion in the Neighborhood, and Compassion to the Society. Al-Rahma fi al-Usra, al-Rahma fi al-Jawar, al-Rahma lil Mujtama. So the three aspects. And we can share that and share it with Brother Iyad al-Nashif and with our Sheikh, especially here, that we can use. Now, there are some verses in the Quran have been misinterpreted. Would you like me to go over those very quickly? One of those two. Then I have a question and answer. مثلا عشاء. الآيات مثلا أقتلوهم إيش حيث تقفتموه. There's آيات in سورة البقرة and there's آيات in سورة النساء. Those two places. Violence extremists, whether Shabab, whether Boko Haram, whether ISIS, they use them, as well as Fox News. Fox News use also the same verses to distort Islam. And I would like to explain just only one aspect of this ideology, deconstructing it, to show you how people misunderstood the verses. Let me ask you, if somebody quote this verse to you, I'll show it to you in the Quran, he said, explain it to me, what do you say? Huh? What is ISIS? Kill them wherever you find them. Exactly. Kill them wherever you find them. You heard this verse or no? It's in the Quran, we made it up. Yes, but it's the فانسلخ الأشهر الحرم إيش؟ فقتلوا المشركين حيث تقفتموهم. When the 4 months, second 4 months is over, kill the mushrikeen wherever you find them. Exactly. It's out of context. Thank you. But the Quran said don't transgress. But when he said don't transgress, what that shows you? If the Quran in the beginning said, whenever you find them, and then he said, لا ولا تعتد, don't transgress. Okay, let me explain to you. Those are verses was revealed after the incident of Hudaybiyah, of Fath Makkah. Muslims, during Rasulullah Sallam time, they had a treaty with people of Mecca, Quraysh, not to fight for 10 years, for 10 years to have peace. And they established alliances. The Rasulullah and the Quraysh, they can choose whomever want to be part of this treaty. Different alliance. Hilf. With the Rasulullah, the alliance that joined him is called Banu Bakr. With Rasulullah Khuza'a, with Quraysh Banu Bakr. Rasulullah, the group that joined him is called Khuza'a, and the group that joined the Quraysh called Banu Bakr. Banu Bakr and Khuza'a used to have war, fighting among themselves before this tree. Some of Khuza'a are Muslims, some of them are not Muslims. Banu Bakr, all of them are not Muslims. When they get the treaty, when they have the treaty, the children of the elite of Quraysh, with their fathers been killed in Badr, they did not accept completely the authority of Abu Sufyan. And they didn't like the treaty to begin with. They want to undermine the treaty. Among them, a person become a Sahabi later, Ikram ibn Abu Jahl and others. They told Banu Bakr, when they saw Khuza'a doing Umrah, going around the Kaaba, after the treaty, he said to them, kill them now. Get your revenge. They said, but you have a treaty. He said, forget about the treaty. Just get your revenge, we'll help you. They killed them while they're doing the Umrah. Khuza'a went and complained to Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And Rasulullah Sallam declared what? War against Quraysh. When they came to Fath Mecca, this group, whom Rasulullah Sallam told the Quraysh before he won the war, he said, if you bring us the people who commit the crime, we'll let go. If you pay the blood money, we'll let go. If you don't, then we have war. They refused to do the first two. Then Rasulullah came to Mecca. This group of people ran away to Taif. The group who committed this crime, they ran away to Taif, another city. Then the Quran says, kill them whenever you find them. To this group of people who commit the crime. وَلَيْسَ كُلَّ عُمُومَ الْقُرْآنِ عُمُومَ. Not everything is in Quran, it looks like general is general. I give an example of this. Quran says, وَأَفِيضُ مِنْ حَيْثُ أَفَاضَ النَّاسِ. He says, join Arafah as other people join Arafah, as people have joined Arafah. Because Mecca, the Quraysh, they used to not to be part of Arafah. They used to stay in Mecca. They said, we are the custodian of the Kaaba, therefore we will not mix with the pilgrims. The Quran says, no, be with them. The word nas here does not mean all people. It means what? Only pilgrims. Another ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, الَّذِينَ قَالَ لَهُمُ النَّاسُ إِنَّ النَّاسَ قَدْ جَمَعُوا لَكُمْ فَخْشَوْا. Allah talking about the Hamra al-Asad incident. He said, the people are the, when the people have told the people, الَّذِينَ قَالَ لَهُمُ النَّاسُ إِنَّ النَّاسَ قَدْ جَمَعُوا لَكُمْ, that people have gathered to crush you. Although you use the word nas, it doesn't mean all the people, it meant only Quraysh. This is a very technical issue, by the way. I don't want to bore you with this aspect of explaining this. But the word Nasara and Yahud, when you see it in the Quran, it doesn't mean all the Christian, nor it means all the Jewish. I'll give you an example of that. Allah says in the Quran, وَقَالَتِ الْيَهُودُ عُزَيْرُ بْنُ اللَّهِ. Allah says, and the Jews said, Uzair is the son of God. You know how many Jews have said that in Medina? Three people. But he describing them to be Jewish because they identified themselves to be Jewish. فَلَيْسَ كُلَّ عُمُومَ الْقُرْآنِ عُمُومَ. You cannot generalize. And among that, the misquoted hadith by ISIS, Shabab, Boko Haram, مُرْتُ أَنْ أُقَاتِلَ النَّاسِ. Allah command me to fight people until they testify La ilaha illallah. Is that true? He fight all people? It's not true. You have Jews lived in Medina among Rasulullah, they're not Muslims. No one forced them to become Muslims. Nor the Christians who lived in a Muslim land being forced to be Muslims. The other problem with the ideology, they divide the world to two abode. They call them abode. Darul Harb or Darul Islam. The abode of war or the abode of Muslims and abode of war. This is no longer accurate description. Hada tawsif. At the time, they describe a political situation. In Islam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, لا ينهاكم الله عن الذين إيش؟ لم يقاتلوكم في الدين ولم يخرجوكم من ديارهم لكم أن تبروهم وتقسطوا إليه. الله سبحانه وتعالى does not prohibit you to be kind, to be gentle to the people who never fought you, never prevented you from practicing your religion. Be just and be fair to them. Therefore, this group have taken verses out of context. I wrote a paper on this. You can read it. Now it's online. You can go to onetrueislam.org. Deconstructing all of this idea. onetrueislam.org. Now, one of the biggest problems we have with this ideology, it is the lack of understanding of the general Muslims to those issues that I just mentioned to you. And if when those children join, their parents doesn't know the meaning of those verses. Their children have more expertise in those verses and the understanding, although distorted understanding, more than their parents. Their parents, they cannot give them the answer. The last point I'd like to make and then have open for question and answer, that some of this violent extremism is situational, being caused by wrong policies, caused by aggression being committed to against a particular community, and it become reactionary. although a wrong reaction, but we have to think also about the political cause of those issues. And those issues have I raised with the American government, from the White House to Homeland Security to State Department. As well, I raised it with the Nigerian government, the Sudanese government. And some aspect of this had to be understood of creating the condition sometimes where the violent extremism grow. Do you know about malaria? What caused malaria? Mosquitoes. Where the mosquito, how the mosquito grow? What caused them? Huh? Stagnant water. Therefore, you have a stagnant water, and they have the mosquito, and they have the malaria, and have the person been impacted by the disease. You have options. When a person gets the malaria, then you give them the treatment. Or you get rid of the mosquitoes. When you get rid of the mosquitoes, you have to get rid of what? Stagnant water. Violent extremism like that. There's mosquitoes, and there's the transmitted diseases. And we have to have prevention and intervention and rehabilitation. You have to address all the aspects of it. But you have to look what the stagnant water is, what the cause of it first. And then you do intervention, because you want to do prevention to make sure that doesn't take place. I'll stop here. Jazakumullah khair. Any questions we'd like to ask, so we can engage in these discussions. I summarized a workshop that they do in about 7 hours. Go ahead. Yes.
Why did this extremism surface in the last 10 years? Why not before?
Yes. Why we see the increase of violence extremism? Okay. There's external factors and there's internal factors. External factors, it is the political conditions in many Muslim world. A failing state, dictators, dictatorship, lack of freedom, lack of justice. That's one aspect. Second, is that the internet made it easy for people to propagate twisted ideology. Anyone can go to Sheikh Google and ask questions. And people don't know which is the authentic source of Islam and what is not authentic, for they fall in the trap of asking the wrong Sheikh online. Third, is the lack of empowerment, youth empowerment, that we see. Now, more than ever before, the Muslim population is younger than more than ever before. Do you know that? In, for example, I went to Senegal, and I realized in Senegal, about 70% of populations, 70%, believe it or not, under 30. 70% of population in Senegal, under 30. And you have that across the globe. Lack of opportunities, lack of directing the energy of youth, and lack of creating a platform for youth to direct their energy in the right place. Even the wealthy children. The children have money and opportunities even in America and Europe. That's some of the cause. But what troubling to me, some Muslims says, why are you talking about violence extremism? It bothers us. Don't talk about it. Brother, it should bother you when you see a person blowing up a mosque and during Jum'ah time and killing people in Kuwait, in Saudi Arabia, and Pakistan. It should bother you. It should bother us when a kid traveled from Minnesota or from Virginia or from Michigan all the way overseas to blow up himself. With the cause, he doesn't know what it's all about. It should bother us. Yes?
Do you think there's any one single trend in our
Yes, hateful ideology, foundation of it, of I have the purest Islam and you don't have any. That's the beginning of it. I'm holier than thou. I am it. And I can give you any time a label of kafir if you disagree with me. I have to look for a reason to put you out of Islam. It come out from ideology, it's not a particular country, but many ideology come from narrow interpretation of Islam. And for so long, we have those literature, free literature in our masajid and around the world. We need to expose it. Yes, you have a follow-up question? By the way, the first suicide bombing, it starts with the Tamil. Japanese and then Tamil. Huh? With the plane. Therefore, it's not the Muslim, the first one, have done this. Okay? Other people have done it as well. Okay? But that does not justify it. You see, as we as Muslims, we have to explain this is not only us, but we should have to take responsibility of the misunderstanding of Islam by saying what it is. But I should not take a responsibility of other people's action. You cannot have the Muslim in Mexico to answer to the crazy Muslims in Sudan or Syria or Iraq or whatever. I don't have to answer those. But I have to prevent my children from doing such ideology. You see, in your reaction to the events in the world, there are three levels. The level of control, the level of influence, and the level of inspiring people. By the way, violent extremism, they do the same thing. They have control, influence, inspiring people. What is in my control is what kind of Islam I'm teaching my children. What kind of Islam I'm teaching in my mosque. What kind of Islam I'm teaching this Islamic school that in my community. That's in my control. What kind of curriculum are we using? Our influence, we can influence government and policy of CVE. We can influence politicians and foreign policy as much as we can. Okay? To inspire people by establishing a good community, a model, maybe people in Ohio says they want to do what people in Michigan are doing. That's how we approach things. Okay. Now, Brother Iyad, you raise your hand. Percent of terrorist activities in this country by non-Muslims.
So my question is, I think our community has been incredibly proactive, relatively speaking, about CDE kind of activities. Do the other faith communities that are associated with this 94% of the terrorist activities, are they taking action similar to what we as a community are taking? Is there any kind of collaborative effort, an interfaith kind of initiative, because like the last thing that I want to do is to be the only one trying to defend or pushing that accusation when the others are actually the ones that are carrying on this kind of activity in this country.
Very important question. I raised with the Attorney General 2 weeks ago, the new Attorney General, this issue. And I challenged them. I said, there's 94% of violent extremism in this country conducted or done by non-Muslims. I want you to have a press conference every time you arrest those people, not only press conference when you arrest Muslims. Because the American public, they need to know that violent extremism is not only coming from the community, a Muslim community. And I pushed it, this is the second time or third time I pushed it. And I said, I want to show us when you're going to do that. And when you do it, we have to know about it. And they promised this time they will do press conferences. 94% are not religious based per se in America. It's white supremacist activities. And it's targeted into local. It doesn't have national agenda, they say, per se. I mean, but it's still, it is terrorism. And we need to have, the other people have to have their share in publicity of this. I agree with you 100%. Okay? But let me tell you the things that trouble me too. In America, there's about 27,000 gang groups, gangs, 27,000. It's about 800,000 members of those gangs. There's 14,000 cases of violent crimes in the United States every year. 14,000 people being killed. All the violence that we see, all of us, is something that we have to stand against. But what troubles you and I is somebody say to somebody, come and do this in the name of Islam. We should prevent it because it's distorting the image of Islam. We do it because also committing injustice toward others, creating mischief and corruption on earth, innocent life being taken. We do it because we love our children, we want to make sure our youth does not join this kind of cult. That's why we're a proactive community. The other people might not be proactive like we do. Excuse me. But it's our responsibility to be active and respond to this crazy ideology. Because the damage of it is greater for our community than for the larger community who are the majority in this country. Yes. Yes. Oh, sorry, though. I didn't say. Assalamu
alaikum. First of all, thank you for giving us this opportunity to bring this subject to us, which we tend to maybe not ignore it, but don't pay attention to it. I have a general question. Most of us parents are not knowledgeable. And so it's the kids, as you said, kids come around and cite an IR and so forth out of context. What is being done at the level of our learned people, imams, to combat this issue? Not quietly. You know, we have a powerful group of people. At least every week, Friday, we gather and we listen to khutbahs. By and large, what my experience is, those khutbahs are limited to whether we are going to go to Jannah or not. You know, every little effort, all the citations from the Quran, from the Hadith, are advocating to the people, to those people who are already in the masjid. At least they have had some concern about it. That's why they are there to pray Jumu'ah. I yet have to find a concerted effort at the level of the learned people and the imams to say what is happening and what the interpretation is, these people are wrong people.
Yes, let me just first, in the defense of imams, I have heard many, many imams, including your imam, speaking against this issue. The problem we have is that the imams are so overwhelmed. And ISIS and ISIL, they have professional teams 24 hours on the internet. But your imams have to bury the dead and to get married, get people married, and to have to counsel people and to have, you know, teach the classes and so forth. He doesn't have time to be online 24 hours. What you need to do, and this is my proposal to Muslim community in America, actually. If you go to onetrueislam.org, we have a campaign now online. It's called $1 Campaign to Defeat Violent Extremism. What we do in this $1, that we creating a operational team, operational room, where the young people being taught by the imams are the one who responding in general of the ideology. They're creating a positive thinking about Islam instead of reactionary. Because we have to talk about meta-narrative, not alternative narrative of Islam. Because ISIS, Shabab, Boko Haram, they don't have an Islamic narrative. They have a distorted ideology. We have the meta-narrative, the true Islam. The true Islam has to be online. You have to engage young people online. You have to have virtual Islam as well as physical Islam. And therefore, the idea here is to train the trainers and to have the imams in every masjid have two or three people to answer the call as the imam, but the one who answering is a young person who they're asking the imam the question and they're answering online. Okay? Therefore, this is one aspect of it. The second aspect of it, to teach people the positive behavior that Muslims sometimes, when you talk about Islam, we are always doing the negative aspect of it, sometimes. What I mean by that? That I wanted to prevent myself from going to hellfire. That is positive. But when you do that, are you proactive of doing the positive things or passive by just withdrawing? What I mean by that? The imams might say, don't do this, don't do this, don't do that, don't. But he lacked the list of do. Not your imam. Sometimes we have lacked the list of what you can do. But always we talk about what you cannot do. Talk about the haram. You don't talk about the halal and the proactive. Therefore, Islam being presented in negative context. Our Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, for example, when a young man was eating with him, and he ate with his left hand. And he didn't say Bismillah, and he ate from the place of others. What Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him? Yes, he didn't say, do not eat with your left hand. That's negative, by the way. This is very important. You have to be cognizant of this in changing behavior. Enforce the positive, don't dwell in the negative. He didn't say, you should not eat with your left hand. You could have said that. He said, Ya Ghulam, Sammillah. He didn't say Bismillah. That's negative. He said, when you eat, say Bismillah. That's a positive. Eat with the right hand instead of mentioning the left hand. And he said, eat from what in front of you? Instead, he said, don't eat from other places. You have to have this positive attitude of changing people's behavior. I have a whole workshop on behavior changing according to some perspective for the Sheikh.
Thank you very much for sharing your thoughts with us on this important topic. And the good news is that we have a very active Imams Council in Michigan that have Sunnis and Shias. This experience, alhamdulillah, has been shared with so many other communities in the States. And the press conference we held in Dearborn has been covered by US Today and so many other national
news agencies.
The question I have for you is that many of these youth who went to this
direction, they always make the argument that democracy, American Western liberalism, and capitalism, and all these Western systems did not work, did not serve us. We have been looking for our identity, we tried to find it in these Western systems, basically it's not working. And of course the situation in Syria and Egypt and Libya and all these states show that it's not working. So the only way to work is to go back to Islam through jihad and establish Khilafah, and then Islam in its totality will be established in social, political, we have to go back to the root. So this is how they try to attract more people, because it's not working. So the only alternative to the Western systems is going back to Islam. That's why they choose the word caliphate and khalifa and khilafa, and they try to do zakah system and so on. So what would be the response? It's like a dichotomy between either Western or their understanding of Islam.
First of all, you're right. This is one of their arguments. And actually, one of the parents in Sudan, he said when his son told him this argument, he said, I didn't have an answer for him. I didn't know what to tell him. I said, okay, son, I know these people are wrong. Don't follow them. I don't know this kind of argument you're telling me. He couldn't respond intellectually to this argument because it's very appealing and very powerful. Now, first of all, they misunderstood the Islamic perspectives of change. Because what the young person wants to do, he wants change. That's what he's looking for, change. Changing of conditions, improving Muslim situations. What you need to do, you want to say, okay, this guy, Baghdadi, said I'm the Khalifa. See what kind of change he brought. He brought more disaster, he killed innocent people. He killed, Muslims. He destroyed villages. He brought war, expanded the war in Syria and Iraq. What kind of change he has? For better or worse? For worse. That's the first argument. Okay? The second is that if the Sahaba, radiallahu alayhi, the Sahaba, when they went to Sudan, when I went to Indonesia, they says we want the Khilafah, we want this and that and that. And we want to change the political system. Do you think the Islam would have a spread there? Third, that you have to believe in the issue of priorities. This young man in prison, he was very adamant. He said, Imam, is it true in Islam that you have to change the munkar with our hand or not? I said, yes, it's one of the aspects of it. He said, therefore, why are you not telling people the truth? I want to change the munkar, the wrong things with my hand. That's what he told me in the beginning. I said to him, do you know that it's not all the time you change munkar with your own hand? He said, where? How's that? I said, you can see a munkar and you are able to change with your hand, but you don't change it. What? I said, yeah. I said, the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he entered Mecca after Fath Mecca, and he knows that the Kaaba is not being built on the foundation of Ibrahim alayhi salam. See, the Kaaba is like a triangle, red triangle. It is not a square. Even now, the Kaaba, not all the sides are equal, by the way. When Quraysh want to build the Kaaba, they said we should build it all only with halal money. No haram money. They have a lot of money, but not, most of it is not halal. They brought only the halal money. The halal money, there was not enough to build the whole Kaaba. They built it until the Hijr of Ismail, alayhi salam. Hadrat Ismail, alayhi salam. You see this place called Hijr Ismail? This circle is part of the Kaaba. They couldn't build it all the way, therefore they marked the boundaries of the Kaaba. Now when you do tawaf on the boundaries of the Kaaba actually. You go like this, although the Kaaba is here, this half circle, you go. If you to pray inside this place, as if you have prayed inside the Kaaba. Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, after they opened Mecca, he has the power, he has the means, he has the halal money. But he didn't do it. قال السيدة عائشة لولا أن قومك حدثوا عهد بجاهلية لهدمت الكعبة ولبنيتها على قواعد إبراهيم ورجعت لها بابا. If it wasn't of your people just came out of Jahiliyyah time, just come from ignorance time, they just converted to Islam, especially Meccan people, I would have demolished the Kaaba and rebuilt it in the foundation of Ibrahim alayhi salam. Why he didn't do it? It created a social disorder. قول فقه المآلات. You know the consequences. Allah is the right thing to do, but it's not the right time to do it. Even something like this. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Abdullah ibn Abi Salul, the head of Munafiqeen, said about Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, first he accused his wife Aisha, Hadrat Aisha radallahu anha, Umm al-Mu'mineen. They attacked the honor of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Umar radiallahu anhu said, Ya Rasulullah, let me kill the man. Umar radiallahu anhu was already ready for action. Umar radiallahu anhu was very emotionally charged. Rasulullah every time what? Stop him. Stop him. Not to do things. Because he wants to think long term. Until Abdullah ibn Abi Salul said, Wallahi la irraja'na ila al-Madina ila khujanna al-azu minha al-adhal. He said, but by God, when we go back to Medina, the man of honor, talking about himself, will kick out of Medina the man of no dignity. He meant the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, a'udhu billah. His own son stood at the door of Medina. He did not allow him to get in. He said, I will not let you get in until Rasul sallallahu give you permission. But Rasul sallallahu he called Umar radiallahu anhu, he said, you see, now his own son is stopping him. لو قتلته يوم قلت لي لارتعدت له أنوف. If I have taken his life or killed him the day you told me to kill him, many people have reacted and respond to him defending him. I would not have done that. Furthermore, I told this young man, he was shocked as if this man doesn't know the seerah, the young man who tried the Twitter account of ISIS in the United States. I asked him the question, I said, do you know that Rasulullah prayed janazah on Abdullah ibn Abi Salul? He said, I don't know that. I didn't know that. He said, he prayed janazah on him. Let me answer this. Allah Almighty, does he know Abdullah ibn Abi Salul munafiq or not? Khwana, do you have heavy dinner or what? That he knows that Abdullah ibn Abi Salul is munafiq, hypocrite or not? Allah Almighty. Does Allah Almighty knew that Rasulullah about to pray janazah on him? Why Allah did not stop him before he prayed the janazah? Why he told him after he prayed the janazah? Think about it. Think about it. The problem is the people don't know seerah. They don't know how Rasulullah reacted. I told him that the Muslims, through the history, understood the gradual changes. The people whom the Quran talks about and Rasulullah talk about of hesitance called hamiya, this hamiya, they want to respond quickly. They always make mistakes. In America, democratic society have legal means of challenging authorities, of asking for change. Those people who said that doesn't work, they have not tried. You can speak to people and you can change policy. We spoke to people in government about racial profiling. We spoke to them about training of law enforcement, and we have changed that. People don't have patience. They want it now, want to change now. That's the problem. Yes. Absolutely, one of the biggest problems challenging governments and the international community in violent extremism. It is suppressing of freedom and legal means of changes in many Muslim countries. Suppressing people who might have a Islamic point of view of how they see politics. By putting them in jail and killing them, that's not going to help. Because people say, look, democracy does not work, let us use violent extremism. I said that to the people in national security in America. That's an issue. Yes? That is a very important question. 80% of victims of violent extremism committed by Muslims are Muslims. The more people, like in Sudan, for example, the group of people, some of them non-Sudanese, argue with the imam in the masjid, very conservative masjid, like the Salafi, they call them in the Sudan, Ansar al-Sunnah. They argue with them, and they went. In the next day, they brought Kalashnikov and killed all the Musallim while they pray in the masjid. They blow the masjid in Kuwait, in Pakistan, in Saudi Arabia. They kill people inside the masjid. Because those people believe. If you don't believe what we believe, you're out of Islam. Your blood is lawful. They have a distorted belief in Islam like Khawarij. They are Khawarij Uhad al-Umma, Khawarij Uhad al-Asr. They are Kharijat of this century. Any other? Yes. First of all, I would like you to connect to your local imam. And your local imam can tell you where to go. He will tell you which website he trusts and where you can go. That's the first line of defense. The other thing is that there's a criteria being used for hadith. To reject hadith, you should use it for also judging people. قَالَ إِذَا رَأَيْتَ الْحَدِيثِ يُبَيِّنَ الْمَعْقُولِ ويخالف الأصول ويخالف المنقول ويناقض الأصول فاعلم أنه موضوع. If you find a hadith that contradicts what's rational and disagree with the fundamentals of Islam and disagree with the text of Islam, you must know it's fabricated. This is a ruling that has been taught in Ilm al-Hadith. The same thing, إذا رأيت الأراء العالم تخالف المعقول. If you see somebody, say the scholars, he says something that's not rational, and contradicting the text, against going against the text, and it goes against the principles of Islam, you have to know it's fake. But in order to know that, you have to know this. You have to know what is text and what are the fundamentals of Islam. Like, I cannot understand. There's no justification for somebody holding a Muslim guy from Indiana, ISIS, and executing him and killing him. Doesn't need a sheikh to give you a fatwa on that. That's why I asked this young man, do you know this man is Muslim? He said, I don't know, maybe he was not a good Muslim. I said, if a person is not a good Muslim, you just kill them? Well, what he says that? Where? He He said, I don't know why they did that. I said, you know what I told him? The reason that people go and follow this group because they have little knowledge of Islam. And I will end with this argument. I asked him, I said, now I raise doubt about them taking life of innocent people. One person, you couldn't give me a good answer about why they took his life. I have a list of them. But isn't that enough for you to say if they're handful of the blood of that one person and they may be being wrong of killing him? I know for sure they're wrong. And you know you have your mother as a single mother taking care of you. It's true or not? He said yes. I said, taking care of your mother, is it wajib in Islam or not? He said, it's wajib. I said, do you want to go to Jannah or somewhere else? He said, I want to go to Jannah. I said, Rasulullah said, if you take care of your mother, you go to Jannah. Am I correct? He said, yes. I said, there's a doubt ISIS will take you to Jannah, according to what you say. He said, yes. I said, why don't you da'a ma yuribak ila ma la yuribak? Leave the something that's doubtful to something not doubtful, which is your mother. Why I should go and join a group? I don't know what they're doing. At that time, tears come to your eyes. That's the only time he broke down. I cracked it. Like I broke his code. And as he done, he promised me. He said, after he told me this, I promise you one thing. I will not join any group unless I understand Islam very well. Simple as that. That don't let people misinterpret Islam and give you a wrong understanding of priorities in Islam. You raise your hand. Policy of Muslims. Number one, you go to onetrueislam.org. We're collecting now. You just put your name. You don't have to be the full last name. Say, I agree with the fatwa of the Fiqh Council of America about violent extremism. And there's an affirmation. Let us create a movement addressing this issue. Number two, let be proactive, create positive understanding of Islam. It will take care of the negative. This propaganda, because you have to be proactive, as I said earlier, and we have to create a meta-narrative of Islam. We should not have doubt that these groups have created more damage for Muslims than benefit. ودرء المفاسد مقدم على جلب المصالح. Preventing corruptions and mischief have priority of gaining benefit. And we have not seen any benefit come from this group. ايش تعمل ذا؟ سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك لا اله الا انت استغفرك واتوب اليك. جزاكم الله خير والسلام عليكم.
الله أكبر الله أكبر